Well, thank you all so much for coming. For those of you that don't know me, but I know I think mostly everyone here, my name is Crystal Burr and I work here at 108 Contemporary. And I just want to say thank you so much for coming and getting out the cold and snow to be here. And also, I'm just curious, raise your hand if you knit it, or seamed, or donated yarn, or...
Yay!
Well, thank you so much to those people. Community-based and focused, and honestly, very literally, it would not have happened without everyone working together to make this possible. And it also would not have been possible without Romy. let's give her a hand. As many of you know, we're a very small staff here, and
you might have to deal with that.
We're a small staff here, so we really could not have done what Romy did for this project. As far as the artistic vision of really putting content in it, making it more than just this community-based piece, but also everyone worked together to create a work of art. It was really Romy's artistic vision for that, and then also her ability to travel all around the state. Guys together. So today she's going to talk a little bit about her process, and then we'll have time for questions and answers. So with that, we'll get started.
So it's like I instantly just seeing the hands go up with how many people help, like I've got Misty. So I start to break down. Like I hope you will forgive me. Give me a second to compose myself because this still, even with the hindsight and with being through the whole process, like I still have moments of like very raw emotion attached to this experience because it has been a journey. Like I can't, there's no other word for it. So I wanted to start with this slide just because this is the fresh as a daisy slide where it's like, look, it's got all the lights are on the building. And it was a sunny day, which is of course lovely. I love lens flares. I don't know if those of you who don't know the overall body of my work, I actually am mostly a photographer, and knitting and fiber art like this is a relatively new endeavor for me in my 10-year career. So I'm always a little bit happy that I can also provide some really great images of my own work because, yeah, I know how to do that. So the first thing I want to do is talk about how this started. And over in the back, our back door neighbor here is Hardesty Art Center, AHA. And I was part of Art 365, which is an Oklahoma Visual Arts Coalition exhibition that happens every 3 years. And I was chosen as one of the artists for that. And I knitted this room, which I did entirely by myself. I can totally talk at length about this. I'm not going to, but. This was a pretty labor-intensive process. I learned how to knit to make this. So I learned how to knit in April of 2013. I knitted this is the second thing I think I made ever. Like I've done two experimental small pieces to learn how to figure out gauge and how to knit and purl. And then while I was installing this at Hardesty, Emily came over. Emily was the director here at 108. She came over and said, I have this idea. I really would like for 108 to have this project that includes people from all over the state. And I love that yarn bombing and knit bombing is a thing. Do you think you could lead that? And I had just, like the day before, had been a part of an artist talk where I said, I never want to knit again. Those of you who do knit know that in a repetitive mode, or crochet, or needlepoint, like anything that we're all doing repeatedly with our hands, like carpal tunnel is a very real thing. Headed stretch motions are really very authentic pains happening, and I just really couldn't even imagine. But I said, you know, let me think about it. And if you are an artist and you are presented with the opportunity to work on a building size scale in a supported way? Yes, the answer is yes, absolutely. I'd be happy to do that. How can we do this? Let's think about how to do this. And so the process of going through just even, can I commit to what would be another year of bidding? No, it's worth it, no matter what. And yeah, it was worth it. Will you, next slide, please. So I started, and this is, it's a little just a synopsis, and I have to give a nod to Facebook, and if Mark Zuckerberg were here, I'd probably kiss him square on the mouth. This wouldn't have happened without Facebook. And this was my first post about the project, which you can't read because it's tiny. But it was October 14, 2014, and I put a post out there that said, hey, are you an editor? Like, I'm going to do this thing, and I've started this group on Facebook, and please join it, and please spread the word. And literally through that action, and then one away saying this is happening, and then the word of mouth of the people who were involved in it. Right now we have 409 people in the group. I anticipate, if I were guessing, I would say probably 400 people had their hands on this project in one way or another, either as a knitter who contributed or as a person who was very generous in buying yarn for the project, or the seamers, which, man, like the knitters were critical and very important. The seamers had a thankless job, and I couldn't even begin to go into depth about how hard in such a very short period of time we put the whole thing together in Oklahoma City, and that the scene was great. So, one post, and here we are 15 months later, and it's on the wall. So, you advance to the next. Starts with buying yarn. So, yeah. I have actually four or five pictures. You're not going to see them all, but four or five pictures like this. All of the green and blue yarn. And so, one away bought yarn, I bought yarn, and then individual knitters contributed yarn. It was a lot. It was a lot of yarn. Overall, thousands and thousands of dollars went into yarn purchases. For me personally, and I know one away felt strongly about this too, you have this community project, and you're trying to pull in people regardless of socioeconomic background, or regardless, of course, of religious or political or geographic, any of the things that we consider divides in our normal life or through our Facebook persona or anything. This has to be able to be accessible to everyone. So providing yarn for people so that they can be a part of this regardless of any of that was a very important component to me. So if one awaits in the process of purchasing yarn through the internet, which is of course the least expensive way to buy the yarn, but it hasn't come, but I need yarn because I'm going to a knitting circle, then I'm going and I'm buying yarn because I don't want to show up at a knitting circle empty-handed and be like, thanks for knitting, and now will you go spend $10 on yarn? All of you. It wasn't a feasible part of it. So the yarn was a big part, and there were lots of shopping carts filled with it where I just go in and literally buy everything in the country. And then we started with the knitting circle. So Oklahoma City, Tulsa. This is at Tulsa School of Arts and Sciences. Is that right, Carl?
No.
And Carl connected me with the teacher there. They had a knitting club at TSAS, and that was great. And then at Klassen School of Advanced Studies in Oklahoma City, this is Sarah Braden, who is a very well-respected fire artist, and her son goes to the school, and they have a knitting club, and so he comes. So all these kids contributed squares to the project, which is great. Ponca City had midnights in a bar, which was all my favorites. Stillwater still has a they started a knitting circle just for this project, but it has transcended it and moved in. As you can tell, I'm a huge fan of the panorama, which I did with this group, and Kelsey said, you want us to move our heads? Because if you move halfway through, it does a super cool thing. So if you ever take a panorama photo like that, and you have a large group of people, and you ask everybody to move, their bodies will be still, but this is just a blur of crazy, and it's like, hey, see these monster things. Lawton and Enid and Guthrie were all instrumental. I told Donna she was going to be in the And then St. Luke's. And then there's this group in Norman. Oh, gosh, this the project, they invited me to come, and I went down to Norman several times. And this woman is a librarian, Sarah, and she is the leader of this group. And she, for one of our name nights, she read us the story about this little girl who knits. And then her teacher, she was like, I'm gonna knit sweaters for everybody in the town. And the teacher was like, that's impossible. And she was like, watch me, and she did it. And the reason I included this slide is because in the beginning, in the very beginning of this, we, 108 and I, over the intercom, like we're reading this rejection letter, and we're reading the reason why we've been rejected for this one grant that we had applied for. And it was because of one reviewer who said in the review, in the feedback, we don't know who this man or woman is, but his feedback probably was that it was too ambitious. And there was no way that one person could do this on this time schedule with this many people. And it's like,
at
After I got the sorted part and I was able to do counts, like how much light blue, how much dark blue, how much medium blue, how much white, how much gray, I was able to go home and I made about 8 versions of this to kind of figure out, okay, we have this much light and this much dark. How are we going to organize this so that as a visual piece, it's not chaos, like that it does have a sense of landscape. And at the end of the day, it is art. I mean, it could have been completely random. Like, I'm going to put this piece of this piece, and it would have had its own charming and interesting way in the way that it, like, no matter how this information is organized, it's going to have an impact of overwhelmingness because of the scale. But I love the light to dark. I think the light to dark worked really beautifully, and I think that it really enhanced a lot. I tried a lot where it was like light to dark, or light to dark, or I thought about, like, what if it's literally like this panel and this panel, or just trying to think about all the different things. But this is what we settled on, and it helped with organizing the squares in that way. And then we started singing. So here you see a process where we had quite a few people in the studio this one night working on greens, which was really great. Came to Tulsa for the Oklahoma Arts Conference. If you didn't get to see the show that was in this space prior, it was Crystal Wagner had this massive plastic installation that was this abstract form, you get a sense of it. And Carl and Isabel there knitting or seaming together the landscape. The Oklahoma Arts Council was very gracious in letting us set up during the conference, which was over at the Hyatt, and people came. But the night before the conference started, we came in here and Channel 2 came and Tulsa People, no? Was it Tulsa People? Thank you. Came and took photographs and it was great. And that conversation was totally a trip. Carl and Isabel are both right here, so it's like I'm looking over here. So this is a perfect example of how small Oklahoma is really and how community is built in these very, like, who could have predicted? They don't know each other before this. They both are coming in to volunteer to do this. They both went to the same school in Minnesota. But they both went to tiny, tiny little school. And 20 years apart, maybe, I don't even know. Like, oh, it's just, you know, oh, I went to one school. Oh, I went to that school. It's just like, if someone, you get it. I mean, it's just weird. And then Ellen, who is Ellen here? No. Ellen was just like, oh, I'm from Topeka. And Carl's like, I'm from Topeka. You gotta love it. I mean, it happens in every state, but I feel like I have a new appreciation for how it happens within our state now, so that's cool. So, with the blues, we started the rolls, like what you saw Crystal with the stretch test before. Make a roll. Carrie, who was there from the beginning, was just like, yep, I totally remember all of this. Make a roll, 9 rolls make into a panel. Had to go for a very specific width. Tom Wallace at Wallace Engineering said, when it was just like, you need them to be this wide, you need them to be this long, so that it will stretch and fit and put all these, and then we're going to seam them together on the building. Using zip ties, magically. So, I just, yarn links in the process. Love it. So once you have those, you start to put them together into these strips. About halfway through the seaming, I had this moment of pure panic. There's no other way to, where I was just like, I'm grateful for the volunteers who were helping me. I couldn't do this without the people who helped with the seaming. I was working 70 to 80 hours a week. I still need more dedicated help, so I hired my friend Claire. And the first day that she came, I had just finished seeing something. She was like, is Claire here? Yeah. I feel like I can do a Claire at the station. She's like, can I commit and go outside the burrito? But only the one time, Claire. I know we're not really. These are all the sky rolls as they got rolled up as they were finished, and then all the round rolls, and then like just the whole process of it. I guess. again, I'm so glad that Steve is here to see this, and I don't mean to keep like being like Steve, but this couldn't have happened in my living room. Like, I could not have done this in my living room. So without the generosity of the patron, he was like, yeah, you can use the space. It was really great. This was the final day of seeming, and I feel like it gives a really great understanding of, you know, we've got all these tables set up, and this is how we're kind of trying to process it. We're tucking in all the tails at this point. You see the horizon. And then once these were finished, I was able to roll them into these giant, like, cinnamon roll kind of pieces that I just thought were so beautiful. I documented those extensively. So carefully, like, rolling them up so they're so beautiful, and then Lisa comes and is like, let's just jam them. So my friends Lisa and Christy had one carload, Kelsey and Julia came in another carload, and then I had two more rolls that I had in my car. In the beginning, and literally this is how completely delusional I am, in the beginning I thought, oh, it'll all fit in my car. And I'm going to need them to help me take it back. So once it all got delivered, the shows that were in here, you see where they're all lined up here. And then just, those construction guys, man. The unsung heroes who worked through all of this. Just watching them like, it's a blanket. So this is when the first panel went up. And there was a scissor lift and a cherry picker that were both instrumental to this, because the scissor lift, as great as it is, it couldn't go between the lights. So we had a cherry picker that could go in this way. Next slide. This is a video, so you can play it. This is the first panel that went up. I stood underneath it. This was before we tethered it to the building at all.
What company did you work with?
Wallace Engineering is who helped us with what is on the building as the weight. And Manhattan Construction is the team of guys that came and literally put it on the building. Yeah. But I'm like the lift alone. But, so in the beginning, I mean, you know, here's a conversation about public art. You have power lines, and the power companies are very particular about how close things are, and it's just like, as soon as we saw how much lift this was getting off, they were like, okay, tether. And now it's all gotta be like tethered to the building, and I think we get advanced a little too. Yeah. So at the end of the first night, this is how much they've gotten up. You can see kind of there's a place where there's a PVC pipe and everything at least is anchored in that way so that it couldn't get as much distance from the building. But I think this was the first time in seeing this. And I mean, this is even radically different from where it is now, but where Crystal and Emily and I were just like, oh, yeah, look, if that's happening. and it kind of looks like a sketch. And kind of doing the thing. There was a moment where we didn't know if it would stretch all the way to the bottom.
Well, I mean, what date was that?
What date was that? That was on the Wednesday of, so, 19th, 18th.
October?
November. Yeah. So, that's how we left day one. This is the beginning of day two of install, where they hooked up a water hose to the fire hydrant on a corner and literally hosed it down. And water is what provides the storage to get it to the bottom. So in the engineering aspect, which is if you make knitting this big and you hang it, it's going to almost double in length, because unless it's like the tightest knitting, the underlying, and none of this was that tight. So because there's stretch, and that's how fiber works. And so we didn't make it so the panels were not designed to literally be the length of the building. They had to be shorter to stretch. If you make it the length of the building, you just wasted a ton of material that is now cooled. This is the Friday before the knitter reception, and Carl and Faruza came and helped do some last minute patching of, like, I don't like that hole, do you? Yeah. Which was really great and super helpful. Dinner reception. Tears. So great. I love this photo. I love that you can see everybody's faces and that people came from Lawton and from Woodward. And of course from around both metro areas. But you know, it really demonstrates the significance of, and this is not even everyone, this is only 90, I think I counted 90 heads in this. The significance of how many hands are a part of this, it's pretty good. And I think this might be my last slide because I felt like this is a good one just to end on in terms of, this is where we were at the conclusion of installation. I love that you get this sense of what's behind, that this is not, it's not in isolation. But even now, like looking at, this is where we got it to in terms of stretch in that first week. And of course now we're on the ground. Like, and not necessarily entirely tethered to the ground, but it's nice to know that it made it all the way to the ground. The difference between now and then, of course, there are no leaves on the trees. There are also no lights on the building anymore. The Christmas storm, yeah, did some damage. Like, here's what's awesome, is in a knitting versus building scenario, knitting kind of won. It pulled off the light and threw it into a tree. It misshaped, it pulled a few and distorted them. And so last week on Tuesday, a team from Manhattan came over and removed all the lights, which is great because let's not have that hazard anymore. That's really fantastic. But yeah, awesome. So if this is about 50 pounds and there are 15 of them on the building, you know, as a dry object, it's not that heavy. It's just the wet. Yeah, and then it just is amplified. And several times during installation, I told this tragic story that is only not tragic because my sister's still alive, about when we were little and we had a swimming pool and me and my friend Nikki told Jenny to go get that stick on the frozen ice and she fell through. Oh. And mom, like 30-year-old mom, goes out with Herculean strength and pulls her 3-year-old daughter with a winter coat out of a frozen swimming pool. And Jenny's fine. She's over there. I don't think she still holds a grudge in it. But the punishment, I know, she's here. But the punishment that my mom made Mickey and I, the only thing that I really have a very visceral memory of it is the coat in the bathtub and my mom making us try and pick it up. I told that story to the construction workers and like anybody who would listen during installation. I was just like, yeah, this is really like, thinking about that and thinking about how a 50-pound blanket, how that triples or quadruples or who knows. I mean, it's, you know, significant. It's significant enough that it pulled things off the building.
Something mentioned too that it rains ice on it, that it's heavier because ice can build up.
Sure. Yeah.
Did they do any studies of?
Yeah. So when Wallace got that one strip and they did the weight test and the stretch test and stuff, they froze it to see how much it would weigh. I just don't even remember any of that. I have slept all the sleep since then. So. Heavy. Yeah. Allison.
Yeah. So one thing that I think is so special about this project is how it unified the mainstream craft, all of the landscape knitters that we see at work with a fine arts project working together making this. So the unification was so great. What about some of the, would you like to discuss any of the challenges you had in people understanding knitting as a fine arts or the use of this medium for this project?
Yeah, you know, it is very interesting to think about knitting and how it how our experience with knitting mostly is Eric's scarf. Eric, will you raise your hand? And this idea, and I'm pretty sure that on anybody who does knit, that's their question. It's like, what are you making? Are you making a blanket? Are you making a scarf? Are you making socks? And because that is what most people, they are making a functional object. And so taking something and turning it into something non-functional, such as a giant landscape of fine art, it was a difficult conversation to have. And even in the beginning, I didn't share this photo, but in Facebook, one of my posts was a stack of squares that I had made at the Oklahoma Arts Conference in 2013, 14, that would have been. And all of the comments were, oh, look, you made pop holders. I did not make pop holders, except that they're not pop holders, but yeah, I mean, our experience with it is in these very tangible ways. It was very difficult to sell a couple of groups on participating in this project because they couldn't wrap around it. The idea that they're not making something that is somehow beneficial or functional.
I just want to add to that that what I think is so interesting is that when I came in murals with the mural team from UCO for years and years, a lot of that paint was donated house paint that we used, and no one ever asked us why we weren't using that paint to paint homes for people.
And so what Allison is getting at, I think, in a perfect way, thank you, is that the number one question that I have received, and I still get it in private messages all the time, is will you turn this into blankets for the homeless? And people don't do that. Oh God, don't we just walk in? What's that noise? nobody does that. No one expects the muralist to go paint homes for homeless houses or for low income houses. Nobody expects that of any other group except yarn bombers. And there are genuine precedents of yarn bombs that have happened where the objects were intentionally created to be blankets that then are broken down and distributed to the homeless or to shelters or to whatever. And that's awesome. These were not made to be blankets. And in all of my research at this point, because I feel like I had to become an expert in what homeless people actually benefit from, this is a burden. Like giving a homeless person, like if we broke these up into blankets and said, here's a giant, messy acrylic thing, this is not a joy. This has now become like this, I'm gonna have to carry this thing around. Like, no, this is not ideal. You wanna benefit homeless people, you buy them the blanket coat that becomes a sleeping bag and has, I mean, like, and it's hard because I personally get incredibly defensive about it. It's enough that it's art.
Well, and I thought, you know, there was a big assumption to think that if you contribute to this effort, you don't contribute to that.
Yes. Right. Yeah. It is. It's really interesting how that broke down. I don't know. And I do get it. And I care about homeless people. I mean,
yeah.
It's not. But art and homelessness are not competing issues. We're not fighting for. You know, it's all important. Okay, I know Chris has had his hand up several times, I promise. Yeah.
I was just wondering, when you started with the Earth 365 project and you decided to actually knit that structure,
yeah,
there must have been some reason you chose knitting, yarn, and that seems to be the link that got you down this path. So I'm wondering what first got you started in that, and if there's anything that then ties into this dialogue that supports yarns.
There is. Absolutely. So for Art 365, artists submit proposals. My proposal was based in photography. Upon being selected for the project, the curator said, I wonder if there's another way you could communicate your idea, which is about being a non-mom. Like I'm not a parent, and I'm of an age where I'm not going to have children of my own. And that was really the impetus for the conversation about that room. And she said, I wonder if instead of doing these photos and sewing it together, if there's a way you can push your skill set and if you can engage the audience in a different way, and it's, and it, let's just see, we have some time, we have a year, let's figure some stuff out. And in thinking about motherhood, one of the things that I felt I kept seeing over and over amongst my contemporaries who became moms is an interest in knitting. I mean, like, literally an interest in knitting. You learned how to knit.
Not well.
But you did. And so did my friend Pam, and so did my friend Janie. I mean, like, there's this kind of thing. And in becoming a mother, cross-culturally, cross-socioeconomic, like, everywhere around the world, you see this as a commonality. And so the idea of making a room that serves as a sanctuary out of this tradition of knitting, out of this art, this like kind of lost craft in a lot of ways, but, and then the humor in it, like, you know, most of our experience with knitting is this, and like the idea that you knit a room is just absurd. So what I, how that ties then in my investigation into knitting and thinking about it even further is, one, there is a tremendous amount of humor in knitting this. Like, you would never paint a mural like this. You wouldn't do it. It would take forever. It would take like 5,000 hours. That's what it would take. And so the absurdity, that humor still carries over. The idea that we've made this handcrafted mural out of knitted yarn and that it is entirely made by hand. All of that is very significant. But also our connection with a technique that really still happens, but it's really digital technologies and our engagement with other pastimes take us away from things that we make by hand. And I know that this is a weird group to be saying that to, because we of 108 contemporary and of a technique that is based in craft, like we all understand the value in weaving and embroidery and in hand sewing and all of these things. And I value that, and I think it's kind of funny to be saying like, society doesn't appreciate this. But outside of here, society doesn't appreciate it. Not in the same way. And so the idea of things that are handcrafted is really, I mean, that's it. That's what carries it through.
Ask one more.
Sure, go ahead.
Definitely all of the hands-on participants that are numerous and incredibly valuable to the project. Could you mention some of the funding sources that also got behind you in this?
Sure. It's a 108 project. 108 was the primary funder. They had the idea. They wanted to do it. We did seek grant support that we didn't get. The knitters contributing yarn would be another significant, like people who bought their own yarn, that was a big deal. It was a big deal. And then in Oklahoma City, there was a group of seven people who helped support the space that Steve donated for the electricity bills and things like that. Like I had to buy lamps, and then of course people who donated tables and chairs. There was a lot of in-kind donations. And then I would say that I was a funder of it. I mean, I bought a lot of yarn. Like, I supported this project personally in a lot of ways. You know? I got reimbursed for a lot of them. The engineers and the construction crew did it all. That was all a connection that 108 had with them. They are part of the Brady Arts District. They contributed all of their time. There is a massive structure on top of this building that is essentially a series of water beds that are inside a trough of wood. They bought and donated all of that, all of the installation, coming back and doing repairs, all of the wire, all of the zip ties. I mean, that was all donated, all of it. Yeah. I mean, and you know what? Here's what's fascinating to me in the hindsight of knowing the budget. You would not believe how low the budget is for this project. I mean, it's a lot for 108, it was a lot for me. But for as many people as it impacted, not only in the making aspect of it, but in the public experience aspect of it, and then to see the scale of it and to see the amount of time spent on it, you don't believe how low the budget is. Like, someone asked me about a project recently and said, well, of course, we don't have a 108 budget. And I was like, it's really overestimating what you think that budget was. Because what that tells me is, you know, like, if you're scrappy, you can get some stuff done for a relatively small amount of money.
What I want to say is that I've been knitting for about 10, 15 years. And I started when I became a parent. And before I was involved in this project, if people asked me, can you make me a hat? Can you make me a scarf? Can you make me something? I would say, sure. Buy me the yarn, I'll make you one. Now, I value my work in a way that I never did. And I say, yes, that's going to take me about this many hours. It's worth about this much. You can afford that.
Yeah. You want to know why hand-knitted things cost a lot of money? It takes time.
I'm surprised when you told me how many artists themselves downgraded what they were doing.
We're all square.
It's not art to them. It's yes.
For some people,
it
is.
And take it back to the water prints on the ceiling.
Yes.
Is that the weight that's holding the panels on?
Yeah. So there are literally wooden troughs on top of the building that Manhattan Construction built, based upon Wallace Engineering design. And they're filled with these giant orange water bladders that are not the size of the waterbed, but they're giant. You can, if you go over across the green, you can see the orange glow from the highway, you can see the orange glow. It's totally wild. These water bladders were taken up empty, of course. You're not going to haul up that weight. They took them up empty on the scissor lift. They put them in place. They used, again, the fire hydrant, ran a hose up, filled them up. On the first day, two of them sprung a leak. They used waterbed patching material and patched them. Yep. And that weight is, then rope is tied to the trough and comes over the building, and the rope holds onto the PVC pipe, and the zip ties make the knitting cling to the PVC pipe. It's all plastic. You're next, RC.
Obviously this, being able to explain this probably opens up an ability to do large projects again, maybe for you, maybe for others as well, because it expands all of our imagination about what can happen. What is next for you?
First I want to say I think that that's totally true. I think that the idea about expanding the possibilities, not only for me, but for others to see what is possible and how, you know, artists need opportunities to challenge themselves. And 108 was, I mean, the gift of letting me have this chance to flex some artistic muscle and work on a scale that you have to have institutional support. You can't do this without. I took a risk within my own practice to be able to do it. 108 took a risk. It paid off, thankfully, for all of us. And hopefully it does inspire other artists to work at this scale. Other institutions to take that risk and support those kinds of projects. I actually have spent a lot of time thinking about what is next for me. And everything that I have lined up for myself for the next 18 months is curatorial. And part of that is because I love the curatorial process. I've become a curator over the past few years. It's empowering artists and helping artists realize their own projects is really something I know that I'm very skilled at and I enjoy a lot. I'll come to the very specific project that I'm working on next in just a second. But I have been working towards a deadline as an artist nonstop since 2012. Like, I have been working hard towards a deadline, and it was concept okay, and then it was Art 365. I had a museum show in there. I had two solo shows last year in addition to this. Like, all of that to say, I worked really hard working towards a deadline, and it's still not a sustainable income. So I've kind of been like thinking about how to continue to be an artist when it takes, my particular practice takes a ton of time, and I'm not getting paid even minimum wage in the end for what my time is. I mean, it's like, the, it goes back to time. It's just like, will you do that? It's like, yeah, I can do this, but then I also still have to do all these other jobs just to pay my bills, you know? It's a real challenge. So that's a little, I get that that's a little off track. But all of that is to say, I'm taking a minute to not art for a second, and to help other artists with projects that they're gonna work on. One of the ways I do that is through, I'm the project curator for DOKC, which is Downtown OKC Incorporated in Oklahoma City. Adam is one of the artists in the next roster of artists. I also curate the space in the underground tunnels in downtown Oklahoma City. I'm excited about that. It's also one of the artists in that. Really coincidental, but it's really awesome. And then Kelsey and I are about to start a project in Oklahoma City in the space where the scene happened, thanks to Steve Mason again, who's been really a remarkable benefactor. We're going to have an 18-month experimental art space that will be artist-led. And then part of the goal of that, without getting too heady into it, is to give artists paying opportunities to experiment and try things and be supported in the way, because there aren't enough opportunities like that. There just aren't. And that's a passion for me, and I think it's really important. It's easy to stay in a safe zone and make the same work over and over and over again, and I feel like we need to have more opportunities where you can really try and see if you can make something new at what you're doing. RC?
The comment and question, I feel like I'm dying to hear it. The comment is that you're getting a bum rap because this isn't really useful, but what about the light, HVAC, and the materials to build this museum? I mean, art museums are not thought to be frivolous, so that certainly doesn't either. You can always find...
Thank you for saying that. The comments board on Channel 6 would disagree with you, but you should never read the comments section. You want to crush a soul, read the comments section.
Some people don't have a lot. And my question is, did you send back to that funding organization
a
picture?
Yes, you got to turn it down.
They know. How could they not know? They absolutely, yeah. No, they do. They know. And, you know, it's kind of...
Your name, not here, from the front.
Yeah, right. When we reached the very, very first goal of the knitting goal, which was August 1st, there was a giant announcement in the Facebook group that was like, I don't want to go to the knitting goal! And you know, like, comment. And it got shared on Twitter, and that organization retweeted that. And I was like, how dare you? You don't get to but you know what? No, actually, they're celebrating in our success too, because they are a regional funding source. They want to support the arts, and look at what Oklahoma is doing is powerful in and of itself.
And maybe they'll find what's like the next time. Yes.
They've learned something, maybe.
Yeah.
I'm wondering how much you felt you had to learn about engineering, structural design in particular. Mm-hmm. Sounds as though you learned more than a little. And I guess my second question is, are the folks at Wallace or anybody else, does anybody have a plan to routinize some of the computations required to do the stress testing of the rest that would be a benefit to other artists down the road?
I think the answer to your last question is no, but that is not to say that they wouldn't be generous of spirit sharing that information if someone wanted it. But I really don't think that Wallace or Manhattan saw this as any kind of like long-term gain of knowledge for them. So I think that they are ready for it to be finished. I mean, you know, like I think that they love it.
God, that might be short.
Yeah.
Actually,
Oklahoma realizes the value of what is happening here at 108 and that this has become a destination to see this thing. And I know that they're proud to be a part of it. But I also know that at the end of the day, they're donating their time and services, and they've got a giant project right around the corner that we've pulled them away from more than once. So I don't think that they probably even, I think that whatever spreadsheet they made, I wouldn't be surprised if it's already been deleted from a computer. Like, that's just not there. Now for me, as an engineer, not as an engineer, but as someone who uses engineering in my work, and it's not the first time I've had to do that, and hopefully it won't be the last time, you know, there was a lot of things that it was just like, yeah, no, that's, it's just logical. And I know that seems really dismissive, like that wasn't really hard work that did go into the computation and to figuring out all of the things that it needed to happen. But, you know, I mean, it's not rocket science. The only part that really did become hard was figuring out what the weight at the top needed to be. And if it had been the solution that I had, we would have screws in the building. But it worked out beautifully. My engineering of it, in terms of the seaming, has been great. And it's really worked out beautifully. So I
think maybe for the weight of the water.
With that
strength, that it was okay with the building.
Well, they know the building because they made the building. They did it.
Bob
might know.
It's special. Well, the way the building, the building was designed to hold lots of different kinds of weight. And it, so they already do. And it's positioned right next to the barrier wall, which is the right place to have.
Yeah.
So, but the more difficult thing on this for me was looking at it as a temporary art project. If you're not, you're going to take it back down. And you'd like to take it down without having damaged the building. So you have some kind of permanent attachment or a structural attachment that you would have had to bolt to the building would have been a bad thing. Rather precedent. If we want to encourage temporary art on buildings in Tulsa, and we're going to have to continue to do it in ways that don't create any kind of damage.
Right.
So this is a great project.
These are concerns, thankfully, as an artist, that I don't have to have. I don't. And hopefully, in the future, anything that I could ever do as a scale would have an engineering team that would make that happen. And so all I have to do is worry about the object and then pass that. And it's just like, nope, I want someone else to. And I'm pretty positive that moving forward, any contract that I have will make those demands. So I didn't know positively, personally, until we did the stretch test and we gave that piece that roll to Wallace and said, here, and they froze it and stretched it to capacity to see if it would break.
For your months of knitting, mm-hmm. for all you knew, you'd hang it and it would all fail.
Yeah.
So you did. Mm-hmm. We're just hoping.
Kind of. Well, I knew enough to choose acrylic yarn as opposed to wool or cotton, which would have a easier rip threshold, like it could have fallen apart easier or deteriorated easier. So, you know, acrylic yarn is plastic. It is spun plastic. I knew it needed to be super bulky as opposed to thin yarn. Like, I mean, you know, you want to have fun going to Michael's and just start pulling on things and see what will break. Because if it will break like this, obviously you can't use that on the building. And there were points where, during the seaming process, where I came across yarn that someone had donated and knitted, and I'm working with it, and it's literally breaking. And now it's like, crap, I have 50 of those squares, and I can't use them now. Like, that became a real thing. The unusables, that's the only other way to put it, is just like, it's got to be strong enough to support it.
You bought the strongest yarn you could and hope it worked.
The process of knitting produces the strongest fabric possible, which is why it's not crochet. So weaving can produce a very strong fabric, and for sewing one piece to another can, but knitting, the act of knitting and what you create from that, it's an incredibly strong and durable fiber. So there was some of this.
Finally, Jeff, we talk a lot about process and community, but I'm you see as this, you know, this is an unbearable absence now, its presence. I mean, what kinds of things inform title? And I think on your website, there's some more absence of landscape stuff.
There's another piece of work that I made that was at the Hardesty in 2012 that was called Bright Golden Haze on the Meadow that has a very similar aesthetic in terms of blocks of blue, blocks of green, horizon line, a little bit of a wave. And it was placed in a window because I am fascinated a little bit with the fact that we've got windows that look out onto concrete and steel and brick. I mean, windows are important in our lives in allowing natural light in, but oftentimes, a window is not a view to something pretty. It's a view to something like that's kind of an eyesore, or it's just like, why is the window have to be so big for me to look at the back of this building?
So landscapes for you become these sort of interior spaces where we have our urban views and.
Well, that is one component of it, but another component that I think is even more significant for me is how watching my nephew, who was here, how watching him engage with screens throughout his life in a way that most of us in this room have not, has informed my experience. So if you're on a road trip and you're with a 10-year-old, where at 10 years old, if we had been on a road trip driving across the country, we might have been looking out the window at a landscape. Kids now don't. They look at this, or they look at this. Like there's a screen, and kids these days always have screens, and it's just a different culture that I know. Every generation thinks the generation before generation. Like I get all of those sociological aspects of it, but I also know that it is a real thing that we, as a community, as a society, have become less engaged with our natural environment. And we are far more engaged with screens, televisions, movies, computers, iPads, iPhones. So this is a pixelated landscape that some people, thankfully, have figured out is conjured up by Mindscape or Minecraft. Because it is, like, Ben loves Minecraft. Ben, do you love Minecraft?
That's so last year.
He's not here right now.
But it is, I mean, like, this engagement with the landscape is a real thing. And I think that there's something really profound from spending time in nature. And I feel personally remarkably, I'm not thinking of the right word right now, but I feel like I have had the great fortune of having some amazing trips where I've gotten to see some beautiful places, unadulterated views, and things that have pushed my experience with the natural world in different ways, with seascapes or with mountainscapes or with just the drive-through. I mean, I don't mean to be like, but the drive-through Morocco is just like, oh, well, let's go see more things outside. Because really, even the drive from Oklahoma City to Tulsa, which I've made, you know, several dozen times at this point, it's like, it's okay, there's some really pretty pockets and stuff. But the last time I drove to Dallas to see my sister and her family, I turned off at a scenic view, like there's a scenic turnoff on I-35. And in March, when I had turned off there, I made some photographs of some things, and it's just like, when you turn off on the scenic views on I-35, there's only one that was a scenic view. The rest is like oil pump, power lines, like it's messy and it's trash and there's not an unadulterated view. But there was this one pristine, beautiful, the hill and the fog, and it's just like, oh, I feel really lucky to get to see this. And then 6 months later, I drive by and I pull off and it is a wind farm. And it is a beautiful wind farm. Like some of the things are beautiful. In a science fiction dystopia way, they're beautiful. Like this 60 mile an hour propeller thing blows my mind and it's so cool. But that landscape's gone now. That's no longer a scenic turnoff.
So the birds.
Right.
Some
knitting room. Okay. I think we've already talked about the knitting mall. You know, I actually have started started a conversation with some people in Norman who are very interested in having it there. And I love the idea that it could possibly have a second life because not, you know, it never was intended to go anywhere other than here. It was made custom to this wall. Like everything about it, the planning, the implementation. But the idea that it could possibly have one other place where people could engage with it and see it, that, I think that the benefit of that far outweighs the amount of work that it would take to do that. And Norman has, in the number of places where people came from, Norman's heavily represented in the knitters. So I feel like, yeah, that's a really logical place. I know downtown Oklahoma City's also interested in it, but I'm not quite sure that, I'm not sure that that will happen. I think Norman's a far more likely candidate at this point. And that is only contingent upon a really large number of factors, one of them being money. And I mean, I'm not saying that in a really like, I need to get paid that way, but like knowing what Wallace and Manhattan have invested in putting this up, it's just like, no, no one's, yeah, it's gonna take, it takes a lot of money to make this kind of thing happen. Whether it's in kind or physical cash, it still takes a lot of money. I think it would be cool. Now, personally, as an artist, I look at this as source material, and I know that at the end, whether it goes to Norman or whether it has another life outside anywhere, I know how I would turn it into sculptural objects. I know how I could repurpose some of this fabric for future installations. Like, even though I don't have a plan to make art in the next few years or the next year, I definitely have ideas about things that I'd like to do. And this doesn't, this plays into it in a lovely way. Like, I'm still very interested in manufactured landscapes. I'm still interested in our experience with ecology. So, yeah, like, it'll get repurposed in some ways. I'm not sure how, but I know how it won't. It's not going to be my life.
It's kind of a related question. So, I find this project as an outsider so incredibly meaningful. There's so many meanings to so many layers of meaning. And part of me wants, as I assume some people would, I want a piece of it in a way. Would you ever consider taking a part in a piece of it?
Yes, and you can talk to Crystal about buying. There is plenty of it to go around. If in any way you are thinking to yourself, you know what, like Christo has done this where he breaks up pieces of his work and you just get a remnant of it. Yeah, that's a very manageable thing. I think we would be happy to see collectors or people who love it enough that they might want to have a piece of it in whatever way they want to have that.
When is it coming down?
I think right now, our plan is that it comes down the Monday after the next First Friday. So it'll have February 1st Friday, and then that following Monday, weather dependent, because none of us want to take it down in a rainstorm or snowstorm or
snowstorm. How long is the publicity?
Oh my gosh. You know, it's really got a lot. It's gotten a lot, which has really been great. The article that came out in the Tulsa World this past week was fantastic. And in all of the things that I've read, James Watts did a tremendous job of capturing the essence and the idea of this project in a lot of ways, which was really fantastic. Tulsa People, Art Focus Oklahoma. There have been a lot of art magazine articles. It's been on Channel 6, Channel 2, here in Tulsa. Explore Tulsa did a segment with this amazing drone footage that is just like, I really hoped that someone would bring a drone over, and then Explore Tulsa brought their drone, and it's just like, that's super cool.
Agreed.
So this is something that needs to be talked about outside of Oklahoma, and for several reasons. And even through the process of making it, that's one of the things that I kept saying, like, man, wouldn't it be great if Oklahoma could be on the news for something that's not awful? If it wasn't for our amazing government or the earthquakes. It would be amazing if it could be outside. The only national press it's had so far is it hit the Colossal blog. And this is Colossal, is an internet site, and they have a web page that's just like, look at this. And then they have also a blog that is like, here's some other cool things that are happening. I think the last time I looked, it was like 9,000 shares, which is just like, wow, that's awesome. I mean, 9,000 people reblogged or posted about it, and that's not nothing at all. In a way, that's not everybody in this room going and sharing it. Those are just strangers. Yeah. Those are people who didn't have their hands on it. I would hope that it would get some national attention, you know, TikTok, I don't know.
You guys are international? The BBC?
Wow. Well, yes. Right? Is that it?
So gracious for him letting us use the space, and putting the logo on the wall really is not equivalent to what he contributed to this project. And as Romy said, we literally could not have done it otherwise. So we have a little piece.
And it's really interesting what they've said to me is certainly in the Oklahoma City art scene, you look at our art nonprofits, how they've grown up, and they started out as art organizations run by artists, now they have boards. So they're like adults. And it's time to birth some more children from an art standpoint, which is a really interesting thought, listening to Romy and Kelsey talk about what's next. We need mature organizations like this place and the city arts and all in the city, but we got to birth more children because they act different. I think it's your point you're going to make.
Yeah. Well, we're responsive in a different way. That's part of our goal. Definitely. Yeah. It's exciting.
So I guess that's the 18th month of venture we're going to start.
Yeah.
Which I sort of understand.